ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا أوفوا بالعقود وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام إن التجار يبعثون يوم القيامة فجارا إلا من اتقى الله وبر وصدقه رواه الترمذي. Dear brothers and sisters, we begin by praising Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send peace and blessings upon the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his companions, and upon all those who have treaded in their footsteps of righteousness and piety. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst them as well. Ameen. Last week we were speaking about how in the Qur'an Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us examples of Dawud alayhi salam, of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that they were people exactly like us. Dawud alayhi salam was a Nabi, was a prophet, but he was also a king. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the last and final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet both of these great personalities, great figures in our history, they were people who earned their own living. They were people who went out and conducted business. The point was that the Anbiya alayhi salam, our deen Islam, is not something which is separate or something which is mutually exclusive from our daily way of life. Rather, we see that the greatest people in our Islamic history were exactly like you and I. They were people that went out and they had to work for a living. They were exactly like you and I after the salah, after our responsibilities. They had that responsibility of earning their own living. Imagine Dawud al-Islam was a king, yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that you should not be taking any money, any wealth from the treasury of your kingdom. Rather, you have to make your own money. Same thing for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was the king of kings, yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that, you know, for you and your family, zakah is not allowed, it's not permitted. For you, you have to earn your own money. And we see that the examples, that this is what the examples they laid down for us. The purpose of all this is to teach us and to show us that our deen is in every facet, in every aspect of our lives. That our deen has some sort of guidelines, some sort of teachings in every aspect of our lives. Not just the masjid, but outside the masjid and everywhere. At our homes, at our workplaces, at our jobs, at our schools, at our classes. Islam teaches us something in all these areas of our lives. We spoke about last week as well that for a person to go out and earn a living, for a person to conduct business, to get a job, and with the right intention, this can be an opportunity for us to earn reward. So for a person who's working 7 to 8 hours a day, 12 hours a day, whatever the time frame, if the person's intentions are correct, if the way he is conducting his business, if his actions are correct, then all those 12 hours or all those 8 hours, whatever it is, then every single second becomes a means of reward. Every single second will deliver him a reward because he is doing it with the correct intention. Today, there's a hadith which we mentioned in the Arabic part of the khutbah, and this hadith is the exact opposite of what we've been discussing last week. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hadith narrated by Tirmidhi, mentions that inna tujjar yub'athuna yawm al-qiyamah fujjara, that the people who engage in trade and business, the business people, all of them on the Day of Judgment will be resurrected as people who are sinners, fujjara, people who are who disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? There's a very strong contrast. That last week, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we were discussing about how Allah gave us examples of Dawud alayhi salam, of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that these people are business people. Yet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us in this hadith that on the Day of Judgment, the people who are tradesmen, business people, they will be resurrected. They will be brought back to life on the Day of Judgment as people who are sinners, as people who would disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there's a second part to this hadith. The second part to this hadith is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa says, إِلَّا مَنِ اتَّقَى اللَّهَ وَبَرَّ وَصَدَقَى. Except for the business people who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who do good, wasadaqah, and they are truthful. In other words, as we mentioned last week as well, the hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that أَحَبُّ الْبِلَادِ إِلَى اللَّهِ مَسَاجِدُهَا وَأَبْغَضُ الْبِلَادِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَسْوَاقُهَا, that the most beloved places to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the masjid, and the most despised places to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the marketplace. Why? Because in the marketplace, in the places of business, is a place where there's a lot of cheating that goes on, there's a lot of theft that goes on, there's a lot of deception that goes on. People are not exactly fair to one another. People don't always tell the truth. And most importantly, moreover, everyone is completely unaware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are completely engaged and focused on earning their livelihood. They are completely focused and engaged in earning their money, that they completely forget about the hereafter. They completely forget about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the people who can distinguish themselves, the people who can separate themselves from the norm, from the default, and become people of awareness, people who are aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even during their workplaces, even during their classes, the people who can distinguish themselves of being of being truthful, of having that value and integrity, those are the people that on the Day of Judgment, they will not be resurrected, they will not be alongside disbelievers, they will not be alongside the sinners. Rather, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, subhanallah, at-tajiru as-saduq al-amin ma'an nabiy was-siddiqin wash-shuhada, that the business person who is truthful, who is trustworthy, that person on the Day of Judgment will be alongside an-nabiyyin, the prophets, was-siddiqin, the truthful people, was-shuhada, and the martyrs, the people who have given their lives for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine, subhanallah, you have a choice over here. Every single one of us, every day, almost every day, we go off to work. Every single one of us have to worry about earning an income for our families. And every single day, we have this choice. We can either choose to be people who are truthful. We can either choose to be people who are trustworthy and have the great fortune of being resurrected on the Day of Judgment alongside the Anbiya alayhim as-salam, alongside the people who have given their lives. Or we can do the exact opposite of giving in to our fears, giving in to our base desires by cheating people, deceiving people, by scamming people, just so that we can have a little bit of extra money. And the consequences of that is on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect us alongside the people who disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So every day we have that choice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us that opportunity. We simply have to make a conscious choice every single day, that which side am I going to choose? Which side am I going to choose today? Am I going to be the person who is trustworthy? Am I going to be the person who is truthful and obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And even if it costs me a few dollars, even if it costs me $1,000, I will always remain truthful and trustworthy? Or am I going to sell my soul? Am I going to cheat people? Am I going to steal from people? Am I going to deceive people just so I can have a few hundred dollars in my pocket? That's a choice all of us have to make every single day. In whatever business we do, whatever business we're involved in, we always have that choice. Right? You have people that are caring, and then you have people that only care about the money. You have people when a doctor sees a patient, they really care about the patient. And then you have another doctor who just cares about the money. And examples like this are everywhere. No matter what business you're involved in, you have that choice. Either you can care about that person, take care of that person, and as a reward, as a bonus, you get money. Or you can be the exact opposite, where you don't care about this person and all you care about is that money, and you do whatever it takes to get that money. And based on your choice, on the Day of Judgment, you will be resurrected either with the prophets and the people who have given their lives, the martyrs, the shuhada, or you can be resurrected alongside the people who disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's a choice every single one of us has on a daily basis. And this is really an opportunity. And this is what I mean by the fact that Every single day, every single moment of our lives, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us an opportunity. Every single day, we have an opportunity. Either that opportunity can become an advantage for us, or it can become a disadvantage for us. In fact, it can become a detrimental for us. Moving along, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He also mentions Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, another hadith. He says, "Inna tujjar humul fujjar." That the business people, the people, and this is not only exclusive to people who conduct business, but anyone who basically works, right? The business people, they humul fujjar. These are the people that are constantly disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then a few of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, أَوَلَيْسَ قَدَ أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْءِ, that did not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make business permissible for us? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it halal for us, then why are you saying, O Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that to be a person who engages in business, you know, it's something evil? So then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, بَلَا, rather the case is, وَلَكِنَّهُمْ يُحَدِّثُونَ فَيَكْذِبُونَ وَيَحْلِفُونَ فَيَأْثَمُونَ, that in reality, what majority of the people who are engaged in business, what they do is they lie to one another. يُحَدِّثُونَ فَيَكْذِبُونَ, you know, they talk a lot and then they lie a lot just so they can sell their product. وَيَحْلِفُونَ فَيَأْثَمُونَ, and they make all these promises and they never fulfill their promises. They tell you, you know, you buy this from me, I'll give you this 2-year warranty, whatever the case, and then you come back the next day, I don't remember telling you anything like that. Or, you know, they'll tell you, look at this great product, you know, this is the best thing you can buy on the market, so on. They deceive us, right? This is the majority of people who are focused on money rather than focused on their integrity, on their value, on their customers. So there's a big difference. And Rasulullah ﷺ points this out, that if you can be from the people who value their customers, if you can be the people who value your integrity, who look after your trustworthiness and your honesty, then that separates you from the vast majority of people who are going out to earn a living. And even when we see in the secular world, aside from religion, aside from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, what Rasulullah is telling us, if we have to deal with someone, if we have to call, you know, let's just say, a landscaper to our house, you know, and we have the reviews in front of us. One review says that this guy is a cheater, he lies to you, he rips you off. And then you have another landscaper and you have the reviews, it says that, you know, this is a really good guy, he does his job properly, and he really takes care of his customers. Who are you going to choose? You're obviously going to choose the good, the better option, the one that takes care of his customers. So even from a secular point of view, we see that people who are trustworthy, people who are honest, they are the people that others like. And the people that deceive one another, you know, eventually they get caught. Like that one guy, you know, that CEO who raised up the prices of some pharmaceutical drugs by 5,000%. Why did he do it? Because he could. He didn't have that value in himself. He didn't have that sense of morality in himself. That, you know, there's so many people that need this medication. He's just after the money, and then now he's in jail. Good for him, right? But this is the reality. Every single day we have that choice. We can either be good, trustworthy, honest people, or we can deceive and cheat and scam people. That's a choice that every single one of us has on a daily basis. And the reward of it, as we mentioned, that for those who are honest and trustworthy, imagine, subhanAllah, just for going out, you know, it's not like you're even going out to the masjid to pray your salah. You're going out to earn a living. You're going out so you can earn money, so you can spend it on yourself, so you can be happy. But just by earning your money in the correct way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us such a great blessing that He will resurrect us on the Day of Judgment alongside the prophets, subhanAllah. And the exact opposite is we cheat people, we scam people, we deceive people, and the consequences of that is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrects us with the people who are fujjal, the people who are constantly disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, this is a bargain. This is a great deal. And when you are trustworthy, when you are honest for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, guaranteed, your business will increase. People will value your reputation. People will value your honesty, your integrity, and your business will soar. So it's not just that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be happy with you, but you'll be happy with yourself. You'll be happy with your business, because now your business will be booming. Right? Nobody wants to conduct business with a scammer, with a cheater, with a liar. Right? So moving on, aside from the obvious that we shouldn't lie, we shouldn't cheat, what's a different way, another way of making our time at our workplaces, at our schools, a much more productive experience is by the way we behave, right? When we go off to work, when we go off to our school, when we go off to our classes, we understand, we know very well that it's not a very good environment. We understand that it's not a very Islamic environment. Why? Because number one, we're probably the only Muslim person there. We're probably the only Muslim individual in our office. We're probably only the Muslim individual in our class. And, you know, the people who aren't Muslims, they don't know the same, they don't have the same understanding of values as we do. And because of that, it's easy to get caught up. It's easy to become influenced. So when we go off to work, you know, there's an un-Islamic environment. We see that men and women are mixing unnecessarily. Men and women are speaking and engaging and talking to one another unnecessarily. I'm not saying that when you go off to work, you know, if a female speaks to you, or if you're a sister and a male speaks to you, you just ignore them, you walk away. What I'm saying is, we see so often that after work, people go out to the bars and hang out. Right? First of all, we shouldn't even be going to bars. But that's the reality, that we have a choice every single day when we go to work. That we can either become exactly like them, or we can stand out, and our actions, our behavior can be a means of dawah, a means of showing people that this is what it means to be a Muslim. That, you know, I'm not going to go out and drink with you. Every single party they have in our offices, every month or every once a month or whatever the case, it's always wine. There's always, you know, alcohol. And, you know, for some reason, you can't have a party without alcohol. And then you have colleagues in your office, or you have classmates who are constantly talking about, you know, oh, let's go party on Saturday night and get drunk, right? Or let's go out for a beer afterwards. Or let's go do some drugs, right? This is constant. Whether you're in school, whether you're at work, we're constantly hearing these things. And as Muslims, we have to make sure that we do not get influenced, and our behavior shows everybody else that, yeah, you know, this guy's a Muslim, and Muslims don't do drugs, Muslims don't drink. They're clean people, right? You don't want to have your colleague saying, oh yeah, hey, let's go, you know, because my Muslim colleague, him and I, we go to the bar together, right? You don't want that happening. So, to make our experience at our workplaces, or our time at our workplaces, a much better experience, a way which every single second of our time at our workplaces will become beneficial and rewarding, is number one, by making sure that when it's time for salah, we pray our salah. So whether we're at our offices, whether we're at class, if it's time for salah, then pray your salah. And it's not like, you know, we only have 10 minutes to pray our salah. We have a pretty long, you know, time frame. We have about sometimes more than an hour. From Dhuhr till Asr, we have quite a good amount of time. From Asr till Maghrib, we have a long period of time. So anywhere in between that, you know, pray your salah. Do not miss out your salah for classes. Do not miss out your salah because of business. Do not miss out your salah because of your job or your work. Right? That's the first thing to keep in mind. That if you can remember to pray your salah during class, during school, during your job, during your workplaces, during your business, then that's the first step. That's the first step towards becoming those who are truthful, those who are honest in the way they do business. Because when you are remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you'll also remember that Allah is watching you. You remember that, you know, this person I'm dealing with, even if I can cheat him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching me. Why? Because you've prayed your salah, you've remembered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during your time period. Second thing is, you know, in our workplaces, there's a lot of rumors and gossiping that goes. There's a lot of rumors and there's a lot of gossiping that takes place. You know, when you walk into class or you walk into your workplace, and the first thing you hear is, you know, oh, you know, did you hear what happened to that person? Or that person is getting a divorce, or that person, you know, has a lawsuit on them, or whatever the case, right? Those are things we have to avoid. Right, as Muslims, we do not engage, and we spent a long time speaking about this, that as Muslims, we are not people that spread rumors, we are not people that gossip, we are not people that talk behind others, behind the backs of others. This is not the conduct of a Muslim. This is not something we should be engaged in. When we hear this at our workplaces, at our schools, walk away from it. Don't, you know, walk away from, don't engage in that conversation. Just walk away. Or if we can't walk away, then remain quiet. But don't get involved, right? Don't become a person who goes around spreading rumors. Don't be that person who goes around gossiping about others, right? So that's another aspect to keep in mind. So far, what we've covered is that at our workplaces, at our schools, when we're there, firstly, try your best to pray your salah on time. Secondly, don't mix with the opposite gender unnecessarily. If you need to speak to them, if you need to refer to them for whatever the situation, no problem, right? But to unnecessarily speak with them, right? To unnecessarily just, you know, intermingle and interact, that is not allowed. We should, you know, refrain from that. And it's difficult, but eventually it takes time. And eventually a time will come where a person will be cognizant and a person will be aware, and they will learn to keep their distance, and they will learn to behave and conduct themselves in a manner which facilitates all that. And secondly is, you know, majority of the time when they have these parties and whatnot, there's always alcohol involved. And I'm not saying, you know, you shouldn't go to these parties, but when you go there, you know, don't drink, right? Don't drink, don't go out to the bars with your colleagues or your co-workers, your classmates. These are things we should avoid. Lastly, is that at our workplaces, one of the things that we often hear so much is ingratitude. There's a lot of ingratitude. People are constantly complaining that, you know, I need more money. People are constantly complaining, you know, this is not going well for me. Don't be that person who is ungrateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be the person who is thankful and content to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? Because everyone is in that rat race. You know, you read some of these books on psychology and some of these books on personal development. There's this one book called, the name of the book is The Small Things Don't Matter. And the author, he's not a Muslim, the guy's a secular, right? He's approaching this topic completely from a secular point of view, from a psychological point of view. And he says the people who constantly complain, the people who constantly run after money all the time, the people who are not grateful for what they've been given, those people stress the most. Those are the people that are never happy. Those are the people that are constantly in anxiety. And those are the people that have no value, no happiness in life. And then he says, but the people who are grateful, the people who are thankful for the blessings they've been given, the people who are content, who make the most of what they have, even if it's small, those are the people who are always happy. Those are the people who are stress-free. Those are the people who have the most enjoyable and happy lives. Right? So it's not about how much you necessarily have, but it's more about how you approach all that. It's about your internal well-being. It's about your attitude. And this is coming from a person who's not even a Muslim. This is coming from a person who's a psychologist, and he conducted research and he found that the people who are ungrateful and always complaining and bickering about what they don't have are the people who are the most discontent, and the people who are always going through anxiety, and the people who are always unhappy. And the opposite are the people who are content with what they have. They make the most of what they have, and they are the people who are happy. So it's very easy to get caught up in that when we go to our workplaces, that we always hear people complaining, oh, I don't have this, or this is going bad, you know, this is not going my way. But that's when we have to separate ourselves and understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ, that if you are grateful, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase you in whatever it is. So we have to learn to be grateful. We have to learn to have a positive outlook in everything we do. No matter what the situation or what the circumstance is, we have to learn to be content, we have to learn to be positive, and we have to learn to be grateful and thankful for the small things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. Because when we are grateful, when we're thankful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you that happiness, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase you in whatever it is that you're grateful and thankful of. Can the brothers please move up? Jazakallah khair. So these are a few tips, a few advices on how we can make the most of our time during our workplaces, at school. You know, it's just very small things. Praying your salah on time. Not getting involved in rumors, gossiping, not wasting your time. You know, making sure that you don't get caught up with the mentality of being ungrateful and developing that attitude of ingratitude. And lastly, and this is probably the most important, is the people that you hang around with, right? The people that you choose to spend most of your time with. Now, like I mentioned, that at our workplaces, at our schools, majority of the time, the reality is that we're the only Muslim there, right? Or along with us, there's only one other person who's a Muslim. So what do you do then? At that time, you have to understand that there are good people and then there are bad people, right? There are bad Muslims and then there are good non-Muslims. So if you're at your workplace where, you know, you happen to be the only Muslim there and you're concerned about, you know, your behavior, you're concerned about being a good Muslim, then you have to find other people, even if they're not Muslim, who don't do these kind of things, who don't waste their time gossiping, who don't waste their time spreading rumors, who don't create that negative atmosphere where they're always complaining, who understand and respect you for being a Muslim, and you have to spend your time with them, right? Don't spend majority of your time with the people who are constantly talking about, oh yeah, as soon as, you know, we get out of work, we're gonna go, you know, a drink. Those are the people we should be avoiding. So there's the biggest thing at our workplaces, at our schools, at our classes, is to make sure that we spend the majority of our time with people who are good, the people who match our values, the people who reciprocate our understandings, the people who understand where we're coming from. Because there's a lot of, I know this one brother who's a nurse, and all his co-workers, all his colleagues, the rest of the nurses know that, you know, he's a Muslim, and during certain times of the day he has to pray. And that's something beautiful. They understand that, they give him his time. Why? Because he's made that effort to educate them. And these are the people that we need to hang around with most of the time. The people that are that negative influence, avoid them, right? Avoid the people that have negative influence. So these are a few tips on how we can make our daily lives much more productive, how we can make our daily lives at our workplaces, at our schools, at our classes, much more in line and in tune with what Islam is teaching us, so that again, every single day, we are making that conscious decision that today I will lead a life of honesty. I will lead a life of being trustworthy. I will be a person who upholds my character and my values as a Muslim. And I will remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throughout the day, and because of that, the reward will be that on the Day of Judgment, we are resurrected, we are raised alongside the Anbiya alayhim as-salam, alongside the Shuhada, and alongside the Siddiqeen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to practice our deen all throughout our lives. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to practice our deen at every aspect, at every moment of our lives. Ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrect us on the Day of Judgment alongside these great personalities, alongside the Anbiya alayhimu salam, alongside the Shuhada, and alongside the Siddiqeen. Ameen. Barakallahu lana wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Majid wa nafa'na wa iyaakum bil ayati wa dhikri al-hakim. Astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa lisa'il al-muslimin fastaghfiru innahu huwa al-ghafur al-rahim. الحمد لله الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك وصل على المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات وبارك على محمد وأزواجه وذريته قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام أرحم أمتي بأمتي أبو بكر وأشدهم في أمر الله تعالى عمر وأصدقهم حياء عثمان وأقضاهم علي وفاطمة سيدة نساء أهل الجنة والحسن حسين سيدة شباب أهل الجنة وحمسة أسد الله وأسد رسوله رضوان الله تعالى عليهم أجمعين. In conclusion, with all that we've been discussing today and then in last week, it all boils down to our approach, our attitude, and our intention. When we go out to our workplaces, to our jobs, to our businesses, when we go out to school, to our classes, it all depends on our intentions. And remember, our intentions have to be in line with our actions. In order to summarize all this, I like to share with everyone what Imam Al-Ghazali, he mentions. Imam Al-Ghazali, a very great scholar of our time, he mentions that in understanding all of this, because whenever we go off to work, whenever we go off to acquire an education, the end result of all that is how we can earn a living for ourselves, right? When we go off to do our businesses, it's all about how we can earn a living for ourselves. Majority of us go to school, why? So that we can have a better future, so that we can have prosperity, so that we can have we can live comfortable lives. So how do you balance all this? Imam Ghazali, he says, لَسْنَا نَقُولْ التِّجَارَ أَفْضَلْ مُطْلَقًا مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. He's saying that we are not saying that to engage in business or to be in the pursuit of acquiring an education which leads to, you know, acquiring money, to making money. Because when we go off to school, why are we earning our degrees? So that we can make money, right? Eventually, that's the end result. Aside from the passion that people have, right? It's also an added bonus. So he's saying, we're not saying that business and education which leads to financial prosperity is the best thing to do. Or we're not saying that it's absolutely fine to do so. He says, but there's a condition. He says, وَلَكِنَّ التِّجَارَ تِجَارَ إِمَّا أَن تُطْلَبَ بِهَا الْكِفَايَةَ أَوِ الزِّيَادَ عَلَى الْكِفَايَةَ. He says, either a person who's going out to do business or earn an income or earn a living, either they are doing it for kifaya, which is to earn a comfortable lifestyle, or they are doing it simply to amass and accumulate much more than what they need. So he says, فَإِنْ طَلَبَ مِنْهَا الزِّيَادَ عَلَى الْكِفَايَةَ لِإِسْتِكْثَارِ الْمَالِ وَإِدْخَارِهِ لَا لِيُسْرَفَ إِلَى الْخَيْرَاتِ وَالصَّدَقَاتِ فَهِيَ مَدْمُومَةٌ. He says, if the person is earning his, is going out to do business simply so that they can amass wealth, so that they can just hoard it and not do anything good with it, so that they are not spending it on other people, then this is something blameworthy and this is something a person should not do. In other words, what Imam Ghazali is saying, that when you earn your income, when you earn your living, do it with the right intention. so you can have a comfortable life, but also so you can help others. If you're doing it for the exact opposite, just so you can show off to people, just so you can have a lot of wealth, so you can hoard it and, you know, use it to denote power, then that is incorrect. So it's all based on your intention. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to have the correct intention. That all this in our deen, it's not prohibited. Our deen teaches us that with the right intentions, the daily activities we engage in can become opportunities of reward. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to understand that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to rectify and correct our intentions so that on a daily basis, everything that we do becomes a means of reward. Ameen. Inna Allah ya'muru bil adli wal ihsan wa ita'i dhil qurba wa inha'i al fahsha'i wal munkari wal bagh. Ya'idukum la'allakum tadhakkarun. Fadhkuru Allah yadhkurukum. Washkuruhu wa la takfurun. Aqimu s-salah. InshaAllah, after the salah, there is